There's so much going on in the world that I think this has really taken a bit of a backstep. Is this because COVID has made us focus on a lot more pressing issues, and so antimicrobial resistance is just not at the forefront of people worry about?
Well, first of all, I think, Francine, you're absolutely right that there is not enough understanding of the very serious and imminent threat of antimicrobial resistance. More than 1 million people die every single year, and it's not just in developing countries, and that is going to accelerate to more like 10 million by 2050 unless we bring forward not only new innovation, but great stewardship and improved policy. So the threat is not sufficiently understood. No. We urgently need to innovate more and incent that innovation. And most critically, which is why we couldn't be more thrilled to be supporting the Fleming initiative, we have to do this in partnership with governments, with policymakers, with regulators, with the general public, but also with healthcare systems and prescribers too. So there's a lot of work to do, and it's so important that it is brought up in public awareness.
And so, Laura Darzi, where's the problem? So this is basically something that's, your life's work, especially at the Fleming Institute, is that are we prescribing the wrong antibiotics? Is it that we don't finish the courses as the doctors say? And why is this also a problem in our hospitals here in the UK? This is not something that's, further afield.
Absolutely. The big challenge here is the misuse and overuse of antibiotics. And as we misuse and overuse of antibiotics, bacteria have been able to develop resistance to the current antibiotics available to us. So we get infections now in which we don't have an antibiotic to treat them with. But thanks to GSK and some of the innovation pipelines that are coming through will help us with this. Why now? We're doing it because we're approaching the centenary of the discovery of penicillin, which in 2028. And if I could just give you one little figure, in 2028, there'll be more people dying of antimicrobial resistance than people died in 1928 prior to the discovery of penicillin. Just to give you the magnitude.
Crazy, yeah. But people don't realize.
Absolutely. And don't realize that. And that is why the big component of this multi-sectoral approach to this problem is not just science, it is actually engaging citizens globally through programs like this. We need to activate citizens that the misuse of antibiotics, either in human health or animal health, may I just say, it's not just human health, could actually have a serious detrimental effect on the efficacy of antibiotics when you're ill, when you really need them.
Is there a quick fix? I mean, this is, of course, is research, but is it, up to doctors and vets to prescribe them less, or is it up to, the public to basically finish their courses?
Well, it starts with making sure that we have a good pipeline of innovation to address some of these resistant pathogens. And at GSK, I'm pleased to say we have a very proud history in antibiotics. In fact, when you look back, we provided 80% of the UK's penicillin during World War II. We have 30 assets in our pipeline. A lot of focus on vaccines, because remember, one of the most important moves we can make is prevent some of these diseases from taking hold and needing scale treatment of antibiotics. But we're also in our pipeline addressing, I think, 12 of the WHO priority pathogens. And these are, frankly, really simple but prevalent diseases like urinary tract infections, gonorrhea, salmonella, shigella. These are diseases that can become really life-threatening if they're allowed to progress. So we need the innovation. Yeah. We absolutely have to get the stewardship, which means better surveillance, a real understanding and investment in diagnostics as well, so we're prescribing the right antibiotics to people that need them, and this public health awareness of completing courses efficiently. So I think this is not a quick fix. It requires sustained investment and it requires deep partnership, which is why the work that the Fleming Initiative is doing, anchored in the UK, but with an intent to have global outposts and multiple partners, is so important. And we, are delighted to support it.
To be honest, it's surprising, actually, because to get any NHS doctor to prescribe anything in this country is so hard, right? So you kind of wonder what it means for other countries where they prescribe antibiotics more liberally.
I agree with that. I mean, we are absolutely delighted with the partnership with GSK. I mean, GSK is one of the few pharmaceutical companies in the world that has 33 new innovations coming in the pipeline. This is not an area that Big Pharma is looking at and investing. Thank goodness to the AMR Action Fund and other organizations. The other missing bit here is diagnostics. You have to appreciate that 70% of prescriptions in the United Kingdom, given to in Europe, given to patients, are without a diagnostic test. There is no other disease in which you receive therapy without getting a diagnosis.
Because it's expensive.
Absolutely. If you go to lower and middle income countries, by the way, you don't even have a GP or a doctor. So you go to a chemist and you have four antibiotics, and if you're resistant, if your bug is resistant to one, those four, you're in real serious trouble.
I mean, I was in India last week and Africa earlier in the year, and this question of getting the right antibiotic for the right disease with the right diagnosis is really, really critical. We just launched purely a data surveillance program called the India Infection Initiative, and where we just bring localised, not just national, but local susceptibility data to different pathogens. And we're already getting 70,000 healthcare professionals just consulting it to understand the right way forward and within the guidelines for prescribing.
Why do you think it slipped from public attention? Again, I don't know whether, you know, the numbers are there, but I don't know whether it's kind of like, pushed back because people don't see it as like...
Well, it's hard to invest in preventative care that's not front of mind. Healthcare systems around the world, including here at home, are under enormous pressure. And this is something that is about looking forward. You know, lots of comparables to everything that's going on the global climate crisis, where we're investing in the future and preventative care. But the time is now because it's becoming really very urgent and it's not a quick fix.
And could I just add the two other value propositions besides the science, which is absolutely critical, is engaging citizens globally in this debate, understanding what this is all about. A bit like climate in the 1990s. Academics were speaking about climate change. The public were completely switched off. We need to engage citizens. And by the way, it's the Bloomberg's activity that engages public and changes behavior. That's a critical component of this. And then the third one, which is even more important also, is policy and regulation. Could we prescribe without a diagnostics? One example. Regulation. Could we label food, which has been treated with antibiotics, to the consumer?
I guess it just feels far.
Yes.
I mean, this is a problem, is that how do you bring that closer to people understanding? Unless you have bacteria that's resistant to antibiotics, people won't necessarily engage with the debate.
We're starting that engagement now. We're starting at schools. Yep. We are engaging schools, kids, to educate their parents. We are really engaging not just beyond health, in mass gatherings. How do you manage infections? And that's the value proposition of this tripartite mission of the Fleming Initiative, which, as Emma said, it's not just in the UK, by the way. We're going to have a centre in one of five continents around the world, one in Africa, one in Asia, because this is a global issue. It's not a local issue.
Are policymakers and politicians listening on this here in the UK?
I think the UK has led the way, not least with the Fleming initiative, but also we're seeing progress in fundamental policies. Because the real challenge for the industry, of course, is when you want good stewardship and extreme discipline on prescription, it's hard for the industry to see when we are working with IP and a program where we're constantly having to replace our business to see really big scale returns on investment in innovation. So the UK is leading the way, actually, in looking at new incentive systems, for example, a subscription program, perhaps a flat fee for an innovation that you can keep in a cupboard, not overused, not overprescribed, but that will save lives in this resistant environment. So I think it does need innovation, not just in products, but in policy, to make sure that effective solutions come through. But again, it's not just the products that we can invest in developing. It's also a big question of governance, of surveillance, of tracking, a lot more work to do. But I think the government are making progress.
Are the pharma companies, you know, present company excluded, part of the problem? Is that they're trying to push antibiotics
to the people? I would say I think the industry has a lot to be proud of on raising awareness here. Whether it be through the Antimicrobial Resistance Action Fund, which actually was pledging an enormous amount of funding for venture capital to invest in new solutions, or building awareness since 2016 when it was first put on the UN agenda. I think there's more to do, for sure. And I'd love to see more people investing in and partnering with the Fleming Initiative, but I think UNGA that's coming up is going to be an important moment to raise our voice together as policymakers and industry.
Does the US have it easier with the Inflation Reduction Act because it's easier to develop some new drugs?
Emma will answer that. I think there are certain incentives there, but at the end of the day, not many people are doing this, thanks to GSK, and many hopefully will join this battle against AMR.
So we have a new government. You're committed to London. You also have a new headquarters in central London.
Yes, just opened yesterday. So.
Congratulations.
Yeah, I'm very excited about that.
What are you hoping to get from this government in life sciences?
Well, first of all, fundamentally, Francine, I'm optimistic. And a new beginning with a significant majority on the subject of healthcare, which is frankly quite a bipartisan issue. I think we should be ambitious for scale change, a bit patient, because this is going to take time, but GSK certainly stands ready to partner. Why I am feeling really quite positive about this, I think everyone now recognises the direct link between the general public's health and the health of the economy. And I think that what Wes Streeting is seeking to do with the NHS, I have huge empathy, by the way, not least with support from Ara, but huge empathy for prioritising patients and the workforce, but also saying this is a country that wants to lead the way in terms of scientific innovation, investment in R&D, and we certainly stand ready to partner with that, with the government, with regulators, and we need this country to be competitive because we want to incent FDI here, not just from GSK, that is a UK company, a proud UK company, with our HQ here, investing more than £1 billion a year, with 11,000 people, exporting 6 billion of products around the world. But my goodness, this field is competitive, and I think we can be optimistic and constructive in the path ahead.
And are you also confident in
absolutely.
Life sciences, but also education?
Absolutely. May I just talk about the bipartisan? I mean, David Cameron was the person who brought AMR to the G20.
Absolutely.
In his day. Let's acknowledge that. Subsequently, Tony Blair, Gordon Brown have been unbelievably supportive to this, and Keir Starmer would be. And we're really looking at exciting opportunities to really deal with this global health seriously.